I would like to first of all wish everyone a happy Independence Day, and I would be today's topic is about the witness on a stand, and we are being joined by Mr. Sastamangal S. Ajit Kumar, who is also a special prosecutor for the DIR and Customs. He's a CBI standing counsel and the advocate at the High Court of Kerala. It's a really pleasure to be for us to be working with him, and I hope that all of you will enjoy our session. And before I give the platform to sir, I would like to ask everyone to unmute themselves, and if you have any questions or any queries, please drop in the chat box either to Outspoken Narrative or to me, and I, by the end of the session, sir will be clearing those doubts for you. And please do not unmute yourselves in between the session. And if you all have filled out the Google Forms, please fill out the Google Forms if you want to get the certificate. Thank you. Now I will be giving the platform to sir. Sir?
Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, sir. You're audible.
Yeah. Okay. Can I be seen also?
Yeah. 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 So you're being seen also.
Okay. Okay. So today the subject that has been given to me is witness on stand. So I have been introduced to you. I am a practicing lawyer. I enrolled in the year 1983 in the Kerala Bar Council. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Ah, okay. Yes, sir. I enrolled in the year 1983. I started practice on 11-12-1983. I started as a junior to late Justice K.P. Radhakrishnan Venu. Thereafter, I had a long stint in the trial court, and I have around 37 years of experience. I have done the prosecution work for the Narcotic Control Bureau for some time, doing the prosecution work for the Customs Department and also the Department of Revenue Intelligence. I am handling cases for them in the Additional Chief Judicial Magistrate Economic Offences Court. And now I am doing the prosecution side for the Central Bureau of Investigation, working as a standing counsel for the CBI in the High Court of Kerala. I have been especially on the criminal side, doing trials, both on the magisterial side, on the session side, and also on the appeals, handling appeals, revisions, etc., on the High Court. So therefore, I think I have some exposure in criminal law. Now, when Niranjana, she asked me what the subject is, then I thought we will take a small subject where we'll be able to focus a little more on the various aspects of this subject instead of spreading ourselves to the entire legal aspects which are there. So therefore, that is why I have taken this subject, witness on the stand. Now perhaps you might be curious as to know what do you mean by this witness on the stand. Witness on the stand, as you know, the witness is a very important person in a criminal trial next to an accused. The most important person, as I always felt, and I am firmly of the belief that the most important person in a criminal trial is the person who has committed the crime and he is accused. And I always felt that he is a VIP in the trial. That is why we give a lot of privileges. Say, for instance, we start the trial by saying that he is presumed to be not guilty unless it is proved. There is a presumption of innocence in his favor, which has to be altered by evidence, either oral, documentary, in the court, etc. So next to the accused, the most important person, the next level of importance is the witness. Because without an accused, I said there is no trial, there is no case, there is no judge, there is no prosecutor, and there is no witness also. So therefore, a witness is a person who is very closely aligned to the accused. So let us first understand what is the definition of the word witness. Various dictionaries have given various meanings for this word witness, and I go to the Webster, where the definition of witness is given as a person who attests to a fact or an event. That is, say for instance, in every will that is executed, you must be knowing as to what is a will, because I presume that most of you are students. Am I correct? Hello?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah, please. Otherwise, I am feeling that. Yeah, please.
Okay. No, sir, you're audible. Everyone
can. Is it correct if I ask you that most of you are students of law? Am I correct? Most of the participants, I mean, are you students in law or are you advocates? Large majority?
Yes, sir. We are
Law. So therefore you must know what a will is. A will is nothing but a testament by which the testator gives his property to a person which is to come into effect after his death. As simple as that. So a person who attests, for instance, a will, attestation of a fact. What is the fact there? The fact is that the testator desired to will his property in favor of the beneficiary. Okay. So that is attestation that a witness in the will has to say. So therefore, a witness to a will, a person who attests a will, or even, in fact, he sees an event, that is called as testimony. Now it happens in various forms. Say, suppose a murder takes place in front of your house, the police officer comes there, draws up a mahasar, a sketch of the scene of occurrence, then prepares a note regarding that we in Kerala we call it as mahasar. I don't know what you call it in the north. So there the mahasar, that is what the police officer has done with respect to the scene of the crime, that is attested by two persons, generally two persons. They are called as witnesses to the mahasar. What do they witness actually? They attest to the fact, please understand, they attest to the fact that they have seen the police officer having come there and having noted the particular facts that he found at the scene of occurrence at the time and also at the date specified in that document. So therefore, the witness testimony in that respect becomes very, very important. That is why most of the criminal defense lawyers, when these witnesses to the scene mahasars, when they are brought to the box, either the witness are, for instance, bribed by some way, either cash or kind, to turn hostile to the prosecution. I'll come to that. What do you mean by hostile? Hostile to the prosecution, that is to speak against the prosecution. Or in case they speak for the prosecution, then the only tool by which they are cross-examined is to the circumstances under which they happen to be present there, and a general challenge that they were not present there at the time when the alleged document was prepared, and that they had some business to do in the police station, they had some business with the police, and they were forced or compelled by virtue of those circumstances, by reason of those issues, to attest their name as well as their signature to the document, and that what they now testify before the court is a false testimony which they compelled to say by reason of those factors which I said right now. This becomes very important, very important. Probably you may feel that this witness testimony, after what is there in it, but then this is a very important fact. This testimony is very important because, say for instance, and you know what is the recovery evidence under the Evidence Act? Probably you must have read what is Section 27 of the Evidence Act. Section 27 of the Evidence Act says that notwithstanding anything, provided that when any fact is reported to by a person in the custody of a police officer, whether it amounts to a confession of that, so much of that information, whether it amounts to a confession of that, is admissible, distinctly relating to the fact discovered is admissible. I'll take you to Section 27 of the Evidence Act. This is a very important document, very important provision, not a document, sorry, very important provision, which is very often used by police officers for the purpose of proving a fact in issue in the trial. Say, this is how a rereading of this provision will be very, very profitable. How much of information received from accused may be proved, provided that means it is a proviso. What do you mean by a proviso? A proviso is an exception to the general rule. What is the general rule here? A general rule is given in section 25. That is a general principle. Hello?
Yes, sir.
I'm okay, no?
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. Section 25 is the general rule. Section 25 states that confession to the police officer not to be proved. No confession made to a police officer shall be proved as against a person accused of any offense. Say, suppose you commit a murder. You go to a police officer. You tell him that, sir, I have committed a murder. I took up weapon number, MO number one, MO one, took up MO number knife and stabbed the deceased to death. That statement you give to a police officer. That statement to a police officer is not to be proved. That is what it says. So that is a general rule. But there are exceptions to this. See that the word says is a confession to a police officer. All persons who do investigation are not police officers. You must be aware of that. A police officer gets a definite definition in law. A police officer is a police officer only in accordance with the provisions contained in the Code of Criminal Procedure. So therefore, a police officer, in order to satisfy the term, will have to be a person who investigates a crime after registration of a first information report under section 154 of the Code of Criminal Procedure and takes up an investigation under section 157 of the code and thereafter submits a report under section 173 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. That position is clear. If you don't do these things, that is, if you don't register an FIR, you need not, it's sufficient if the head constable registers an FIR, but you should take up the investigation. Do the investigation under 157. Thereafter, you question the witnesses, either oral, documentary, collect the digital evidence, etc. File a report under section 173. If you don't file a report under section 173, if you file anything else other than a report under section 173, you are not a police officer, and you are not a police officer, which will fall under section 25. No doubt, the question that will be roaming in your mind is why this fellow is telling you again and again about the importance of the word police officer in section 25. I will answer it. Now, you know customs officers, revenue officers, you know officers under the NDPS Act, persons who are authorized, persons who are empowered, etc. You come across a various number of officers who investigate a various types of crime cases, and thereafter they engage upon the task of prosecution. Say, for instance, a prosecution under the NDPS Act done by custom officer, done by an excise officer, done by a narcotic control bureau officer, etc. All these fellows, they are not police officers. They are persons who do not file reports under section 173. Okay. If you want to know the fundamental decision, you go to the Supreme Court decision 1968, Supreme Court there. There is a decision followed by Justice Ahmadi in 1999, I suppose. Anyway, you look up the year. Anyway, the fundamental principle is this. That is, if you are a police officer, you must do those activities which I told you. Yes, no. If you don't do that, then you are not a police officer. So therefore, what happens? If you go to a narcotic control bureau officer and thereafter tell him that, sir, it is true that when I was going to my college, you restrained me, and thereafter you searched me. You told me that you are an officer under the NDPS Act, and you also told me that if I want, I have got some rights under Section 50 of the evidence of the NDPS Act. You read to me the provisions under the NDPS Act. Then you told me and made me aware in the language which I understand that if I want, my search of the body can be conducted either in the presence of a gazetted officer or in the presence of a magistrate. And if such a requisition is made by me, and that I have a right to make such a requisition, and if such a requisition is made by me, you have an obligation to take me to a gazetted officer or to a magistrate as a force. Okay. So therefore, you gave me those rights, and thereafter I told you that I do not want to exercise those rights. I'll be happy if you do my search. And thereafter, you, as well as the police constables present around you, made a search of their body. This search was done in the presence of the two search witnesses that are named in the search mahasa. Thereafter, from my right, right pocket of my pants, you recovered 100 grams of heroin, which I kept it in my right side pocket for the purpose of sale to some persons who use this heroin in my college. It's a very profitable business, etc., etc. And thereafter, the NDPS officer, not a police officer, he records that information. That recording of the information becomes a statement. If it is to an authorized officer, that is not a gazetted officer, then it's a statement falling under section 67. If it is a statement given to a person who is a gazetted officer, notified gazetted officer, then it is a statement becomes relevant under section 53, capital A of the NDPS Act. And that statement, if you go to the court and tell the judge that, see, look here, judge, don't you know about the provisions under section 23 of the Evidence Act? Says no confession made to a police officer shall be proved as against a person accused of any offense. So therefore, don't rely upon this confession. It cannot be proved against me. Then the judge will tell you, very stupid. You cannot say that because the person to whom you gave the confession is not a police officer. That confession is admissible under law. And those witnesses to the 50 search, that is the 50 that is the document, requisition document that has been given to you by the police officer, it will be supported by two witnesses. Those witnesses are witnesses to a fact. Fact of what? Fact of the position that such a right was in fact extended to you in their presence, and that you understood that right, and after having understood that right, you waived that right and allowed the search officer to conduct the body search of you. So therefore, that witness will be a very important witness in order to prove whether there has been a literal compliance of the provisions contained under Section 50 of the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Act, Substances Act. So therefore, I took you to Section 25. Now, why I took you to Section 25, you might be remembering that I started with saying that Section 27, unfortunately, starts by saying that provided, and that it is a proviso, means that it is a proviso to Section 25. Okay, Section 24. Now, what does it say? How much of information received from an accused may be proved? What does it say? How much of information means that the whole information is not to be proved. Only that information is to be proved. So, provided that, when any fact is deposed to as discovered, so that means discovery must be there. As though Columbus discovered America. If somebody had discovered America earlier, then Columbus becomes functus. He has no business to do. So this must be a discovery. Fact has to be discovered. When any fact is deposed to us, I tell you a fact and then you discover it. I tell you that I kept the weapon there under the chair, situated on the right side of my office room. Then that is a fact that discovered by the police officer. Deposed has discovered. How it has been discovered? That discovery takes place as a consequence of information given by me. Information received from a person accused of an offense. So I must be a person who must be accused of an offense. So suppose I am a witness. Say I am a person who has been standing in the other apartment and I saw the accused placing the knife under the chair situated on the left side of the office room of, say for instance, Mr. Rajit Kumar. Is it a recovery that falls under Section 27? No. Probably it might also fall under Section 8 to a certain extent as a principle of rescue state, as a rescue state also, but that is definitely an oral evidence of the witness enabling the prosecution to establish a fact that immediately after the murder weapon was found in the hands of Mr. Rajiv Kumar, and it was found by a certain person placing it safely under the table which is placed on the right side of his office room, and that it resulted in a recovery. So now we are going to see the two situations. A situation where you have a witness who is standing on the other side, on the next of my apartment, who has been looking through the window. That lady, let us call her Nikita. Nikita was looking from the other apartment, seeing me putting the knife there. That is a murder weapon. Then also you have the discovery statement. Immediately after my arrest, I became an accused. Suppose the witness has already given an information to the police that has already been recorded by the police before my arrest. Understand? Hello? Are you listening?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Suppose the statement of that witness has already been questioned, recorded, under what provision of the evidence, under what provision of the CRPC statement of the witness is recorded? Section 160, Section 161. I will come to that later. Now, that statement has already been recorded by the police and the police has already made a search of my office, then that means there is no bloody discovery. There is no recovery. There is no discovery. Which is a fact which I told the police officer is already discovered by him. But then take another situation where the witness only says that I saw Mr. Ajit Kumar taking the knife and placing it under the chair situated on the right side of his office room. And then the police comes here, searches my office on the basis of the information that I gave to the police officer. Then The knife is discovered from the inside the seat cover of my chair. You understand the difference? That the knife was kept inside the seat cover of my chair was not a fact which was under discovery. It was not a fact which was witnessed by the witness, Nikita, who was standing on the other apartment. Therefore, this becomes a discovery, even though it will be attacked by the defense lawyer on the ground that, look here, the case diary shows that the witness was examined under section 160 by the police officer immediately after the registration of the crime. She had already told the police officer, look here, you have got the 161 note of the witness, which says that the statement of the witness was extracted, was given, in which the witness says, saw Ajit Kumar holding the knife, dripping with the blood, going into his office, placing it under the chair. There is already a discovery. But that contention will not have life at all. It also becomes a discovery. It also becomes a discovery and therefore becomes relevant under section 27 of the Evidence Act. Then you must then you may ask me, how does it complete? It completes by the discovery distinctly of the fact. What do you mean by distinctly? I tell the police officer that it is a knife that I placed inside the seat cover of my chair. The knife. The police officer recovers a spade. Okay. The police officer recovers a spade. It is not discovery. That is the meaning of the word distinctly. Or for say instance, suppose you have a search witness. You are a search witness and the MO is now displayed in the court by the public prosecutor during the time when the witness is examined. Then the witness to the 27 recovery. Do you understand what I am saying? Hello, do you understand what I am saying?
Yes, sir.
Do you understand what I am saying? Please tell me.
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Yeah. Otherwise, please tell me if you have any doubt, because
sir, you are very
using a lot of legal jargons which is out of context. That is why I am asking you again and again.
No, sir.
If you are not audible, we'll let you know, sir.
It is not the question of being audible. It is a question of being understanding. Do you understand? When I say that the recovery master, do you understand what it is?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Very fine. Now you put the public prosecutor puts up, the public prosecutor puts Nikita on the box, or the recovery witness Toshin on the box, and the witness is asked, say, look here, you have been a party to the recovery, you were there when the police came there, searched the office of Ajit Kumar, recovered, and can you identify the knife? Yes, and the knife is identified, knife is now shown to you. Yes, this is the knife that was recovered by the police in this mahasar. Then the witness says, sir, sorry. Why? This is not a knife that was recovered. When I was there, what was recovered was a spade. What happens to the 27 recovery mahasar? What happens to the 27 recovery mahasar? The 27 recovery mahasar is supported only by reason of the fact that it is supported by an information given by an accused person, resulting in a discovery, and the discovery evidence becomes not inadmissible. The correct word would be shaky. If you are a defense counsel, in your closing argument, you will say the most important evidence in this trial is the recovery of MO1. And the recovery of MO1 is sought to be established by the prosecution by parading witness number one, Nikita, who says that Nikita saw the knife being discovered inside the seat cover of the chair which was situated inside the office of Ajit Kumar, the accused. But unfortunately, the evidence of Nikita is to the effect of that what exactly was discovered was not the knife. She says that it was a spade. Then how are you going to believe the recovery, Mahasar? How are you going to believe the recovery evidence of the police officer? By hearing this, you might be very, very excited. I am very definite that most of you will be desirous of going to the trial court, schooling a witness who comes on a natural. Obviously, the judges do not believe this. The witness will be declared hostile. The judge would say that the witness has been purchased by the defense counsel. And then there are so many decisions of the FS court which says that a police officer to the discovery evidence can be believed like any other witness. Police officer is to be treated like any other ordinary witness. The evidence of the police officer is not of a lesser quality.
Say, for instance, probably you must have seen a film, by Children of Lesser God. Anybody has seen that film, Children of Lesser God? Has anybody seen that film, Children of Lesser God?
No, sir. Sorry, nobody is responding.
Please see that film. Please see that film, Children of Lesser God. Like that, you cannot attack the evidence of a police officer by saying that the police officer is a child of a lesser God. He is also a child of the same God that that created people like this. And then the High Court will say, or the session judge will say, empty number of decisions are there where the court can proceed on the uncorroborated evidence of the police regarding the recovery evidence, provided the recovery is intact. Your cross-examination becomes futile. So this, I was speaking about the witness, about the attestation of a fact. Sorry, I took a lot of time. Then, witness is one that gives evidence specifically, one who testifies in a cause or before a judicial tribunal. What does that mean? Specifically, say that I was standing in front of the flat of Ajit Kumar at 10:45 a.m. today. I saw Ajit Kumar coming down the steps, and as soon as he was about to get into his car, immediately I saw him placing a knife inside his pocket. And I identify that knife very clearly. It is the same crime weapon. And the crime took place immediately thereafter. A witness speaks specifically in a cause. What the prosecution attempts in that case is, the witness is made to establish a fact that the weapon which has been recovered or the weapon which has been displayed in the trial is a weapon which is directly linked to the crime and directly linked to the possession, exclusive possession of Mr. Ajit Kumar. So therefore, what happens? It fascinates me. Becomes an incriminating piece of evidence against me under section 313. If I don't give a good explanation, I'm screwed. If I give a false explanation, there is a full major decision of the tax court which says that in a case based on circumstantial evidence, if you go and give a false explanation, let it be under section 313. What is section 313? What is section 313? Could you put anybody tell me? Hello?
Participants can put in chat box. We will convey it to sir.
What is section 313? 313. Anybody can tell me? 313. 313 of the...
Examination of witness by court.
No, very sorry. 313 is one... Under is a section that is found in the Code of Criminal Procedure where the court after the trial
is the power to summon material witness or something according to
criminal. No, that is section 311. Okay. That is section 311. I am talking to you about the section 313. Section 313 is a very important provision in the trial where the judge is presiding the trial has got the power to question generally and specifically as to the incriminating evidence after the trial or even during the trial. Please read section 313. Very important provision. But then section 313, when I came to you, in section 313, what happens? I will take you to one provision of section 313 and then tell you this aspect of section 313. See, section 313, power to examine the accused. Then, subsection 3 of section 313, the accused shall not render himself liable to punishment by refusing to answer such questions or by giving false answers to them. You understood what it means? I am very definite. See, subsection 4, the answers given by the accused may be taken into consideration, in such inquiry or trial and put in evidence for or against him in any other inquiry into or trial for any other offense which such of answers may tend to show he is committed. So what does section 313 says? Section 313, in effect, literally, it means only this. Anything that you say under section 313, they may not be taken as evidence, but that is evidence in the form of an evidence in the like similar to an evidence given by a witness, either oral or a documentary or digital, etc. But it can be taken into consideration in such train. That is, in order to test the probabilities of what this fellow says, in order to test the probability of the prosecution case, etc., it may be taken into consideration. It may be taken into consideration, not as evidence. But then it further says that he shall not make himself liable to make or not render himself liable to punishment by refusing to answer the questions. When the judge asks me, sorry, I don't wish to answer. Sorry, I don't wish to answer. Sir, I can say, by refusing to answer such questions or by giving false answers to them. I can give false answers to them. So now you will agree with me and you will say that Section 313 generally do not lead to any evidence at all. And the evidence and the accused can speak or he can remain silent. He can remain silent. Okay. But then Section 313 has been given a different interpretation by the Apex Court very recently. Full bench decision of the High Court, I mean Supreme Court, went on to say that beware of your 313. If you give a false explanation, or if you give an explanation which it turns out to be false, palpably false, okay, then it will fill a missing link in the prosecution evidence. How do you reconcile this? See, if this part of the evidence which the accused has given in his 313 statement is taken into consideration, then it is as good as taking the statement of an accused in the form of a witness testimony. Am I correct? Probably not under oath. Agreed. But then it is as good as taking that statement of the accused as that of a statement of a witness. Okay. But then what does subsection 3 and 4 say? 3 and 4 say you can remain silent. You can even give a false evidence. But then let us take a case of circumstantial evidence. Say that A and B are married. See, the neighbor says there was dispute regarding dowry. And there were frequent fights. On day of the murder, B was found strangled to death. The prosecution gives evidence to the effect that A was there and A was the person who was last seen in the company of B. And therefore, by reason of section 106, A has got a liability to speak up as to what happened to B or the circumstances under which B died. 1988 Supreme Court Sarada Birtutan's case, Golden Principles of Circumstantial Evidence. Probably you might have been taught about that. Starting from that trunk case where the body was cut into several pieces and sent. That's a Privy Council decision. Now, the point that I am coming is this. That is, there is no witness for the prosecution in the trial who is able to say the activities of the accused number A on the date when the murder takes place. Okay. There is a vacuum. But then in his 313 examination, the accused takes up a plea that, sir, this murder took place in Ernakulam. On that date, I had taken a flight and I was in the Bangalore airport. I took the flight from Cochin airport at 7:30. Indigo flight I took. I landed at the Bangalore airport by around 8:30. I was there. I did not sleep with my wife. I heard about the death of my mother. I was informed. Immediately I returned. I returned by the first flight. I came down to Ernakulam the next day morning by around 4:30, 5 o'clock. The next available flight I took, I came down. When I came down, I found my wife dead. I am not aware as to what happened. Police investigates.
Sir, excuse me.
Yes, thank you. Come.
Can we unmute people because we are getting requests that they want to answer. So we'll unmute them, those who want
to answer. I'll be very happy. I'll be very happy because I would like to know that you are listening and you are responding to what I am saying.
Yes, sir, okay. There are a lot of people who are asking if they can ask you doubts.
Okay, please do. Now let me complete this, then you come with the questions. Okay.
Fine.
So now the accused, I am the accused, I am, or else I am the lawyer, I am advising the accused. Okay, you tell the judge that on the date when the murder took place, you took the 7:30 Indigo flight and it was in the Bangalore airport by around 8:30. You came, you took the return flight in the night, and thereafter came to the Cochin airport by around 1:30 in the morning and arrived at the house by 2:30. By the time you found your wife, thank you. You say that so that you will be totally out of this crime. It's a very good defense. Section 313, I am advancing this different. Go by the evidence of our ex-governor, Justice Sadashivam. Well, not evidence, the judgment of Justice Sadashivam. Justice Sadashivam says, this is a very, very risky business. Mr. Rajat Kumar, you can do that. You do this, but then if it is shown that this explanation is false, say that the person who took the flight from Kochi, Kochi by around 7:30 by the Indigo flight, was not Ajit Kumar, but my junior, Mr. Toshin. He took my ID. He took the flight under a forged ID, went to Bangalore and came and returned flight. And styling that as though it was me who were traveling, specifically taking up a defense of alibi. Okay. No, let me ask you, have you seen the movie Basic Instinct very recently? It is a 1992 film. Anybody having seen that? Basic Instinct? That's no. A crime story.
No, sir.
Anybody has seen that movie?
No,
nobody.
Sir.
Nobody. Ah, okay. See that movie. That's a case where an author fixes an alibi. It's an American film. Forward film. Now, according to the judgment of Justice Sadashivam, it's a full-based judgment, says that if you speak this fact in your 313 statement, regardless of subsection 3 and 4, I read you subsection 3 and 4 of section 313. There is a bar in treating your statement as evidence in the case. There is a bar in treating the accused as a witness in the case unless and until it comes under section 27. Okay, all this is true. But then, Mr. Ajit Kumar, if this information turns out to be false, that is, the person, the security person of the Indigo flight, the air hostess of the Indigo flight, etc., was paraded in the court, and they give evidence and they tell the court that the person who was sitting in 6A in seat number so and so in the name of Ajit Kumar is not the person who is standing in the dock, but it is Mr. Toshin, who is now identified as the junior of Mr. Ajit Kumar. This evidence, according to the judgment of Justice Sadashivam, will break your defense. And not only that, it will immediately take you to place the missing link in the prosecution evidence. What is the missing link? That there is no evidence to show that you have been with your wife on the date when the alleged murder, on the date when the strangulation took place. It will mean that you have given this false explanation because you wanted to create an alibi. And because of that alibi, you are guilty. That is according to me, that does some violence to subsection 4 and 5 of section 313. Because see how subsection 4 says, and put in evidence for or against him in any other inquiry into our trial. It can only be used in evidence in any other inquiry in trial and not in the same inquiry. So therefore, the plain meaning of subsection 3 and 4 will mean that you can give anyone to false answers, provided it aids your defense. Well, it is good, but the moment it does not aid your defense, you can immediately come under section 3 and 4 and say that don't look into that evidence. 313 prohibits. No, you can't do that. It becomes very, very risky. And it is like taking a 5 lot of Reliance share on a tip from the market. You may or you may not make money. It all depends on how the fate of the witness takes. Now, anybody want to ask any question? Come to that.
Yes, sir. We have some questions.
So I will start off by.
Please come, madam.
Okay. So can I have Salim Kumar? Please unmute yourself.
You want me to unmute?
No,
sir. Kumar. I'll unmute.
Salim Kumar. Please unmute yourself. So his question is there any possibility that discharge will amount to acquittal?
No. Discharge will not amount to acquittal. What is the meaning? There is a clear difference of discharge and acquittal. See, what do you mean by discharge? Discharge is a statutory provision in the Code of Criminal Procedure. You go into a discharge, or you go preventive discharge orders, the provisions in the code enables you to do that. Say it in a warrant case. In a warrant case, you come under section, which section? Section 239. Am I correct? Yes, section 200. When the accuser shall be discharged. Okay. Suppose it is a sessions case. Is there then you come under section 225. 225 speaks of the opening case by the prosecution. 226 speaks of opening. 226 speaks of the opening case for the prosecution. 225 trial to be conducted by the prosecution, and section 227 discharge. See, these are the two provisions for the discharge. But there is another, the third variety of trials under the code, and those trials, third variety is called as summary trials. Summary trial. In summary trials, there is no question of discharge. Discharge is there only if there is a only if there is a warrant trial or in a sessions case. Now, what happens to a discharge? Let us see. Section 227. If upon consideration of the record of the case and the documents submitted therewith, and after hearing the submissions of the accused and the prosecution in this regard, the judge considers that there is not sufficient ground for proceeding against the accused, he shall discharge the accused and record his reasons for viewing. What happens to an acquittal? Acquittal comes under section 248. We will go to section 248. I don't know, my memory is rusty. Section 248. Acquittal or conviction. If in any case under this chapter in which the magistrate finds accused not guilty, he shall record an order of acquittal. Now, when does an acquittal take place? An acquittal takes place only after the provisions under section 211 are complied. Am I correct? Let us go to section 211. Section 211 is a provision that leads to the framing of charges. Chapter 17 deals with the forms of charges, 211 forms of charges, 212 particulars as to time, etc., 213 manner of committing offense, etc., and 214 words and charge, 215, 216 altering charges, 270 separate charges, etc. So therefore, unless there is a charge, there is no acquittal. But a discharge, you need not be, discharge does not take place after a charge. So in the case of an acquittal, all that the court says is that on the charges before the court, you are not guilty. You may have committed the offense. But on the matters before the court, the court is unable, sufficient material, the court is unable to frame a charge against you so that you can be put to trial. So therefore, a discharge is not equal to an acquittal. Therefore, a person who has been discharged, can again be tried for the same offense. Why? Let us go to the constitution. What does the constitution say? What is the principle of double jeopardy? I am very bad in constitution. Let us see what the constitution says.
Article 20.
I think it is article 20, madam, because long time since I studied these provisions. We try to leave criminal lawyers. We are poor persons who live by the fee that we get from the magistrate courts, isn't it?
Exactly.
You're not constitutional lawyers. Okay, let us go into Article 20. Article 20.
So someone has answered Article 20, Clause 2.
Article 20, Clause 2. Please let us read it. No harm is coming. Double jeopardy. Double jeopardy. Yes, Article 20. Article 20 is double jeopardy. Protection in respect of conviction for offences. No person shall be convicted of any offence except for violation of a law in force of the commission of the charge, commission of an act charged as an offence, not be subjected to penalty greater than that which might have been inflicted under the law in force at the time of conviction of the offence. No person shall be prosecuted or punished for the same offence more than once. So therefore, a person who has been acquitted cannot be tried. But a person who has been discharged can be tried. Say the vigilance has booked me for a case. I am a CBI special prosecutor. Now the vigilance has got a report that CBI people have got a report stating that Mr. Ajit Kumar has been taking money for making his arguments loose in the High Court with respect to an appeal that is to come up there. And the money is to be given to Mr. Ajit Kumar. And thereafter they booked me. I was put up before the PC Act special judge. Then my lawyer got up and my lawyer argued that there are no materials to show that there is any demand or acceptance. There is no evidence at all. the hands of the accused did not turn did not show any color change. The fingerprint test is in favor of Mr. Ajit Kumar. So there is no prima facie material to hold Ajit Kumar to be framed charges for the purpose of Section 239. Ajit Kumar stands discharged. Can this case be investigated again? Can this case be investigated? Yes, it can be investigated. It can be investigated. Suppose the CBI gets an additional information that after the discharge, that there are certain persons who saw Ajit Kumar taking money and or Ajit Kumar had purchased some sort of a compound from the medical store, which will enable him to apply it on his hand so that the phenophyllin test will become negative. You understand? Suppose the CBI gets an information that Ajit Kumar had gone to the Madhava Pharmacy Junction, bought a specific drug which can be applied on the hand before accepting money, and if the money is accepted, the phenophyllin test will become negative. The police officer who investigated the charge against me gets this information. What is this information relevant? This information is relevant under Section 1. Under Section 173 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. He immediately files a report before the special judge under Section 173, Subsection 8. Further report. Oral documentary evidence. He gets the bill of Madhava Pharmacy, Madhava Medicals, from where I purchased the medicine. And he also gets the testimony, 161 statement of the witness who gives the statement that I came there and purchased the medicine on the date when the trap was made. Those are all oral and documentary evidence submitted before the special judge. Special judge orders further investigation. Is it not possible?
Yes, sir.
It is possible. Suppose I have been acquitted. Trial takes place. Witness in the PC Act case are so incredible. The CBI case itself is so shabby. Prosecution is very bad. Prosecution is unable to prove the evidence. Therefore, there is no evidence of demand. There is no evidence of acceptance. The defense that is put up by Ajit Kumar in the special judge's court is very reasonable. Probable I get an order of acquittal under Section 248. Can I be tried again? Can I be tried again? No. By reason of subsection 2 of Article 20, I cannot be tried again for the same offense. Whereas, if I had got a discharge, I can be tried again. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
So,
any other questions on this point?
Yeah.
We have a lot of questions.
There are a lot of questions from people.
Come.
Okay. So this is from Srijit B. Sir, can you please unmute yourself?
Pardon me, madam, I did not get your question.
Not you, sir. Srijit B. Can you please unmute yourself? So his question is, whether a central government standing counsel can have a private practice in his own personal capacity as an advocate?
Why are you asking that question to me?
Srijit B, sir.
I guess it is sir's personal query.
No problem. I have nothing. I am very transparent. I take up private cases. So far as that does not result in any conflict with the CBI, I can take up cases. See, when I became the CBI standing counsel, I was having 33 cases against the CBI. All those 33 trial cases I gave up akalat. 33 trial cases, and I was having around 7 to 8 appeals against the CBI. All those things I relinquished my engagement, and that went to the different lawyers. But police cases I can take. Police cases where the CBI does not come into picture and the CBI do not have any conflict of interest, I can definitely take up. That question is targeted at my stomach.
Okay, so another question is by Mateswaran. Mateswaran, he's asking, even if, it was Marianne Judith Norainha. She's asking about what about an alibi then? I think her doubt was about that story. The story that you were talking to us about that time, you were talking about an alibi, right?
Yeah. What is the question? Ask her to frame the question and put it in.
I think she's asking, how do you clearly establish a statement of an alibi, as in what are the formalities?
Nothing at all. Alibi, you see, you know, the defense of alibi is the best defense in a criminal court. Because because it destroys the prosecution case of lock, stock and barrel. You understand? Lock, stock and barrel, it destroys the prosecution case, provided you are able to establish. But in 100% of cases, you always fail to do that. Because as you know, as a defense lawyer who has been in the criminal trial for the past 37 years, most of the cases that the defense lawyers take up, they end in conviction. Am I correct? Where the prosecution is quite strong, isn't it? Especially vigilance cases, cases that come under the PC Act, cases that will be investigated by specialized agencies, etc. That those cases, they end in conviction, especially the session stages, special courts, NDPS cases, then cases under the money laundering, etc. All these cases, they end up in conviction. Why that happens? Is it because the prosecution is very strong? No, it is not because the prosecution is very strong. Because 99% of the cases which the police investigate are true cases. And the problem with the cross-examination, even how much of a best cross-examiner you are, you cannot cross-examine and establish a fact which is not there. You cannot do that. Say, suppose a fact is there. Suppose I say that I witnessed a murder in the front of the church by around 10:30 a.m. where I went for the ceremony at 10:30 a.m. Evidence is let him to say that at the point that I am a habitual drunkard and Mr. Thomas Abraham was a person who always calls me by around 9 o'clock. Both of us go to Hyatt bar and be at the bar if it is holiday, be there at least till 11:30 a.m. and we were there. Evidence is let in to show that I was not in front of the church, but I was in the Hyatt bar at 10:30 a.m. when the alleged murder took place. That's a beautiful evidence. Then the judge will not be able to accept the evidence of the prosecutor. But those things very rarely take place. Very, very rarely take place. So that is it. Now I will come to the question, how do you establish alibi? There is a provision in the IPC regarding the general exceptions. I will take you to that. Corona, unfortunately, first goes into the throat, people say. That is under section 11, under section 11 of the evidence set. Why nobody corrected me? Please correct me. I'm an old man. My memory is getting rusty. Section 11, when facts not otherwise relevant become relevant. Say a murder takes place in Trivandrum. Okay, in Trivandrum. In my office in Trivandrum, Manchur, the murder takes place inside my office. Naturally, I am expected to be there. Even if it's on a Sunday, I work on Sundays. So therefore, you expect me to be there. But then evidence is letting to show that at the time when the murder took place, I was in Calcutta. Okay. The fact that I was in Calcutta on Sunday at 10:30 a.m. when the murder took place is a fact that is?
Yeah.
That is irrelevant. Anavishyamaya evidence. Sorry, I'm speaking Malayalam. It is irrelevant. That fact becomes relevant by section 11. That facts become relevant because of section 11. When facts not otherwise relevant. No. Before going to that, what is the ABC of Evidence Act? ABC of Evidence Act. Evidence Act deals with only two things. Two. What are they?
Facts in issue and relevant fact.
Only two things: facts in issue and
relevant fact.
And nothing else. Nothing else. The Evidence Act is not at all bothered about anything other than facts. This is very important for any lawyer who does either the prosecution or the defense work in a criminal trial. First, you understand that the evidence that the court accepts only evidence of facts in issue. Only evidence of relevant fact. If you don't understand this, you are always doing a misfire. No doubt about it. Now coming to this section 11, facts not otherwise relevant become relevant. Facts not if they are inconsistent with any a fact in issue or relevant fact. The fact in issue is that Ajit Kumar killed Shalini. Yeah, killed B. Okay. The fact in issue is that Ajit Kumar killed Shalini at his office at 10:30 a.m. in Trivandrum. That fact is a fact in issue. But the fact that Mr. Ajit Kumar was at Calcutta airport at 10:30 a.m. at the time when the alleged murder of Shalini took place in the office of Ajit Kumar is a fact which is irrelevant, but it becomes relevant because it is inconsistent with the fact in issue or relevant fact. Then, if by themselves, or in connection with other facts they make, the existence or non-existence of any fact in issue or relevant fact, see the word that is used by the legislature. No wonder. I know a friend who takes evidence act very clear, who has bigoted the entire evidence act. One Mr. Kalakutta Narayanan. You know, he says that the person who authored the evidence act, Mr. James Stephen, ultimately went mad. Have you heard of that?
No, sir.
Yeah, he went mad. See the word that is used. Fact in issue, relevant fact, highly probable, not a simple probability, highly probable or improbable. It has to be highly probable or improbable. Otherwise, no. That this fact that Mr. Ajit Kumar was in the Calcutta airport at 10:30 a.m. when the murder of Shalini took place in his office is to be a fact, not probable, but it has to be highly probable. How is it highly probable? By producing the ticket. By producing the ticket, not sufficient. By identifying Ajit Kumar, how do you identify Ajit Kumar having boarded the flight from Trivandrum or Madras airport at that particular time? How do you prove that? By my boarding pass, by my security check, departure through the exit gate, CCTV footage, etc. All these evidence should be produced in order to make this fact highly probable. That means Mr. Salim Kumar, Salim Kumar asked the question, I think. Mr. Salim Kumar, it is not sufficient if that fact is probable. I give a ticket before the court and say that, see, look here, this is the Indigo ticket from Madras to Calcutta. It shows that I traveled in that flight. The judge will ask you, stupid, you just shut up. You're not going to step that. I know where you were. The prosecution has sufficiently proved that you were in your office and you committed the murder of Shalini. That I am fully convinced. Now you have created a DTP. You have created a DTP ticket of Indigo flight from Madras to Calcutta, and you are trying to tell me, you're trying to fool me by saying that you are in Calcutta airport. No, very sorry. This is not the object of Section 11, Mr. Ajit Kumar. You read Section 11 once again, it says highly probable. You understood?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Anything else?
Yeah, sir. This is a question from Amrita Murukesh. Is there any possibility that we can still prove that the alibi statement is false and restore the statement of the accused?
Yes.
Okay, yes. So this is from Shalu Jose. False statement is punishable under perjury, right?
Yes. Madam, I am a person who is indicted for life. I committed the murder of B. Okay, I am being tried for the murder of B. I am a high risk accused. What punishment I will get for perjury? How many? 6 months, sir?
1 year.
7 year punishment, sir.
It's okay. It is okay. Life is higher.
Sir, my question is different. A little bit different.
Okay. Yeah. Come. Come, madam.
Chalujos, you can ask your question. Ma'am?
So my question is, under 313 statement, yes. Accused is not taking any oath to state any truth,
yes.
And he doesn't need to say the truth. Even if he says false statement, he is not punishable.
Yes.
So what is actually the relevance of 313 statement? Isn't it a waste of time to the court?
This is a very clever question. This has engaged the law commission also. Let us take 313 once again. Let us understand the meaning of this question, what this question does, and how does this question requires to be answered. It's a very interesting question. Let us go to the section 313. Yes. section 313, subsection 5, that came into existence by the Amendment Act of 2009 with effect on 31-12-2009. Earlier also this section was there. Now this section says that this can be adopted by the judge at two stages. One, even without previously warning the accused, he can put questions to him as the court considers necessary. Then mandatory, after the witnesses for the prosecution have been examined and before he is called upon to his defense, they question him generally on the case. So now, see, the question says that is section 313 an empty formality, and why should the court waste time on section 313 if the evidence is there? Don't be surprised. In fact, it is with a certain amount of restraint that I am putting this statement. I think that the Code of Criminal Procedure is the only code which do not adhere to the principles of natural justice. See, suppose I am arrested. When I am arrested, the police need only tell me the reasonable explanation for my arrest. Suppose the court is framing a charge against me. Should I be given an opportunity of hearing for framing a charge against me? No. Suppose the witness is put in the box. Should the court give me a chance as to why the witness is being put in the box? No. There are various provisions in the Code of Procedure where the principles of natural justice is totally barred. It is not there at all. Kindly verify this statement in the light of the provisions contained in this article. Section 313 is perhaps the stage, the last scene in a trial before the curtain falls. And that is a provision which is given for the judge to understand something which probably the prosecution has not said, probably the accused has not said. Now, who was the person who asked that question, madam? What is the name? What is the name of that person who asked that question, madam?
My name.
Yeah, your name, madam? I forgot.
Shalu, sir.
Shalu. Okay, Shalu. Now, regarding that, Shalu, even after the court has sentenced you, the court has got a duty to tell you as to what it is. But in 313 state, in 313, the accused, this is a dialogue between the accused and the court. See the language of section 313. See, let us go to it again. 313. After the witness for the prosecution has examined, before he called, question him generally on the case. So him means accused, and it is the last opportunity of the accused to give an explanation as to the incriminating evidence that is standing against him. So therefore, it is a 313 examination. It's not a mechanical examination. It is not an arbitrary job that is done, but it is a job which enables the accused to have an effective dialogue with the judge, and he is able to tell the judge maybe about a certain circumstance. The judge tells him, see, Mr. B, the witness, the star witness of the prosecution, has testified against you. What have you got to say about it? Probably this may not have come up in the cross-examination or during the trial, but then the accused gets an opportunity to give the reasons as to why the witness has spoken against them. That is why the answers given by the witness may be taken into consideration. See, that is what it says. It's section 313. May be taken into consideration. It may be taken into consideration in such inquiry or trial. So the court has got the business to take those questions, those answers to those questions to be taken into consideration. Probably to adjudge the reasons why that witness has spoken so. This will enable the court to understand whether the witness is a witness of credit and for the purpose of section 155 of the Evidence Act. So section 313, according to me, is one of the most important cardinal provisions in the code, which gives an effective communication channel for the accused to the judge. 99% of the judges may not do this. That's a different aspect.
Mohammed sir, can you mute yourself, please?
Myself.
Mohammed sir, can you please mute yourself?
Can I continue?
Yeah, sir.
Can I continue, madam?
Yeah, sir.
Okay. So therefore, section 313, according to me, is the last communication channel between the accused and the judge, and it gives him an opportunity. So it is not an empty formality. And I have also often felt in many of the trials that the section 313 gives an opportunity, last opportunity to an accused person to give an explanation as to how the evidence fares against him and to the circumstances in which that evidence can be attacked by the defense counsel. There will be so many facts which are particularly known to the accused and which may be inside the bosom of, may not have been disclosed to the accused. All these things, if the accused wants, he can tell the judge also. But according to me, the 313 statement, like the cross-examination, is a double-edged sword. If you do not know how to use the sword, then it is very easy for the prosecution to take the sword from your hand and cut you into pieces. That danger is always there. So 313 examination, 313 preparation is one of the important preparation in the trial. You will have to first decide what are the incriminating evidence against you, and thereafter what should be the answer given to 313 statement and what answers should not be given. If you will permit me, I will draw you to a real life example.
Yes, sir.
Can I take you to a real life example?
Yes, sir.
Okay. A person was having some certificates from the Dubai gemology lab, and also from very famous gem institutes in London, international gem institutes in London, regarding the stones that he possessed. He was saying that he was having the power of attorney of around 315 families belonging to a royal family in Mavelikira. And with the certificate, he said that the upset value of the gems in his possession are 3,600 crores. And he was in fact in search of prospective buyers. It so happened that the first accused in this case came into contact with the person who possessed the gem. And there was a deal. And the deal did not take place. Then the further prosecution case is that there was a conspiracy between A12, A5, accused numbers persons, and they pretended themselves, some of the accused pretended as the one as the minister of the son of the minister of the Karnataka, and another as the son of the minister of a senior bureaucrat in the Tamil Nadu, and another as a gem merchant from Tamil Nadu. They came to meet the deceased and then wanted to see the gems, and in the process when the gems were shown by the deceased to them, then they were in possession of a kerchief which was mixed with the chloroform, it was mixed with the chloroform. Then he was made to smell it, and then he fell unconscious, and thereafter he was strangled, he was throttled as well as smothered to death. And then the dead body was there, and the dead body was put there, and these A1 to A5, they absconded from the scene of occurrence after having taken around 4,500 stones. During the trial, the prosecution relied on circumstantial evidence. And in the trial, several witnesses were examined to prove that the accused person A1 to A5 were found coming down to Tambanur. And thereafter, it was also shown that they had taken into different vehicles like auto rickshaws and taxis, came down to a Vatiyurkava junction, which is a junction very near to the house of the deceased, contacted the deceased, and thereafter the deceased came with the car of his friend, got into the car of his friend, and thereafter they had gone into the house, and they were seen going into that house, and one fellow was standing in front of the house, etc. Then after the murder, it was also testified that they traveled in an auto rickshaw and also in a taxi car, and the taxi driver as well as the CCTV footage, etc., were shown. And on the basis of this evidence, and also on the basis of the recovery of around 4,500 stones and odd, may not be correct, I'm just repeating my memory, the prosecution said that this was a murder for gain, and all these fellows, they had conspired to kill him for the purpose of robbing him of the valuable gems from his possession. The first accused in this case, after the trial, their tower location of the different mobiles were also provided in the trial courts by call data particulars. and the nodal officers of the different companies such as Reliance Communications, BSNL, Vodafone, etc. were examined the trial, and also the call data particulars with IME, etc. were also exhibited during the trial. So therefore, the particular location and the grouping of the mobile phones under a particular tower was also exhibited to show that these persons were under the same tower. Then thereafter, accused number one got into the box under section 315. After having given evidence under section 3, and after having given a statement under section 313, and also put in a written statement under subsection 5 of section 313. Gave evidence in disproof of the allegations against him, stating that it is true that he had come down to Trivandrum. He was in possession of that mobile, and the tower would show that he had come down to Tambanur, and he had come down with his wife for the purpose of visiting the Sri Padmanabhaswamy temple. And unfortunately, when he arrived in Trivandrum with his wife became red. So therefore, it was not possible, because being a Hindu, if a lady who has become red cannot be taken to the temple, so she became she became unclean, and so she was made to sit in the waiting room of the railway station. So he went there to the Sri Padmanabhaswamy temple, and thereafter he visited the temple. Thereafter he did the archanas, etc. Then came back, and then he took his wife, and thereafter went back. This is the evidence. This evidence unfortunately backfired. The trial judge, as well as the appeal judge, took note and said that the explanation of the accused given in his 313, as well as statement under section 3135, as well as the statement given under section 315, in disproof of the allegations against him, provides an additional link. And by reason of the fact that it provides an additional link, it was substituted as the missing gaps. It found guilty by the trial court, confirmed by the appeal court. Pending assembly. It was a case of alibi. You understood this is a case of alibi. I am of the firm opinion that in this case, silence of A1 would have done him much better. I still firmly believe so. Because this happens, this is a very intelligent question Shalu had asked me. Because when the trial takes place, see, most defense lawyers are under the impression that the judge is anyway going to believe the prosecution case. And then there is no escape for me. So therefore, this is my earliest opportunity. And this being my earliest opportunity, I will not have any way of defending this case when it comes in the appeal. Because when it comes in the appeal, the only way the evidence can be reopened is only under section 386 and also under section 391 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, where the appeal court has got the power to take evidence. But this evidence, this business, this activity of taking evidence under section 391 takes place only in very, very limited cases. So therefore, when you do the trial, unfortunately, I must confess that Very often, we trial lawyers get into the mindset of the accused. And we have a feeling that we are going to be convicted and this evidence is going to turn the judge on, and that the judge will definitely find you guilty. And it is always better that you give a defense evidence and therefore put yourself in the box under section 315. This is a very, very dangerous business. Very, very dangerous business. This gives you a lot of stress. See, this happens. I will take you to an analog of the business of share trading. See, the first principle of share trading, you must have heard, very successful share traders. The business of share trading means you are ready to face a loss. You understand? When you enter the stock market and you do the business of share trading, you start with the belief that, well, this is share trading. The market can go down, the market can go up, and it is not that the market will always go up according to my position. The market has got its own behavior, and it is not my behavior. Millions and millions of people are there in the market, so therefore, I am always liable to suffer a loss. Only such persons become successful. So, but in the criminal trial also this takes place. See, you know, balance of mind, balance of thought, and being very, very equanimous, I must say very, very balanced, is very, very important in a trial court. That is, you very, very often you get into a fight with the prosecutor, very often you get into a fight with the witness, very often you get into a fight with the judge, very often it happens, and very often it happens. And ultimately, ultimately what happens is it puts you in a very, very bad light. Either you are doing the prosecution or you are doing the defense, it makes no difference. I am just making a very this. So therefore, anybody who does the business of trial lawyering or even lawyering as such, you must be ready. You must be ready and accept that here is a person, a judge, who is ready to find against you. She or he has got the right to decide the case in the way she wants or he wants. And you are likely to be convicted. But you should not go that way. You should think in a very balanced way and decide what is best in the case. Let them think this way or that way. It is not your business. But very often this attitude fails, and fails very terribly, I must say, and confess very terribly. And therefore, most convictions takes place because of the bad handling of the case, bad handling of the witness. If I am given time, I will come up in another session regarding the principles of cross-examination, which I think is very relevant. Although I consider still as a very, very baby who is tiptoeing on the principles of cross-examination. And whenever I thought that I will be able to do a cross-examination very well, I have never left a court with the feeling that I have done it well. Any other questions? Anything else?
Yeah, so there's a question by Hema Menon. It's in regard to this case. Her question is, what makes a case to be qualified to give the CBI? So in the recent Sushant Singh Rajput case, it said that the Maharashtra government refuses to give to the CBI, but the complainant approached Supreme Court.
High Court. See, you know, the CBI does not have any power to sue or to take any cases at all. The CBI is a special investigation agency. That agency is appointed under an executive fiat. Now it comes under the Delhi Police Establishment Act. Under the Delhi Police Establishment Act, the CBI is given powers to investigate only offences that are notified under the schedule under Section 3. Section 3 gives a schedule under which the CBI is competent to investigate. The CBI is competent to investigate a suo motu to take up investigation of cases only such cases which are notified, and only those cases regarding the central government employees, public sector organisations, etc. No other. The CBI do not have any business to enter into investigation of a crime case which is under the dominion of the respective state governments. Because law and order falls in the dominion of law and order falls in the state list under the constitution. So therefore, under the state list, only the state government has got the power to appoint a police agency and thereafter cater to the law and order business of the state and also crime investigation. But then the question comes, how does the CBI come into cases which is investigated by the state government? Those cases come into the hands of the CBI by two methods. One, by virtue of a reference by the state cabinet. The state government take them and decides that a particular case, say for instance, the custody death case, which took place in Kerala, that Nedunganda custody death case where a person was reported to have been manhandled and done to death by the police officials in Idukki, which was investigated first by the local police. Investigation was taken over by the state crime branch. And thereafter, a writ petition was filed in the High Court calling for directing the investigation to be handed over to the CBI. And meanwhile, the state government came out with a notification directing the transfer of investigation in exercise of the powers of the state government under Section 5 of the Delhi Police Establishment Act. That notification was published in the official gazette. And after that notification goes under Section 6 to the central government. And under Section 6, the central government acts upon that notification, and it is the business of the central government to decide whether that case should be given to the CBI or not. Is the central government okay that the decision of the state government is correct and it has to be given for investigation to the CBI, then the central government gives a notification under Section 6 of the DSP Act, and accordingly the case is given for investigation to the CBI. But then the power to transfer investigation of any case to the CBI or CBI rest with the Constitutional Court under Article 226 and also under Article 32 of the Constitution, provided the Supreme Court or the High Court has got reason for that. There are full bunch of decisions as to the norms that has to be adopted by the High Court in transferring, in passing transfer orders under Article 226. Full bunch of decisions in the state of West Bengal versus PCDR, such cases emanating from that. Even recently, there are decisions of the Kerala High Court on this point. So, taking into consideration those norms, the state government, the High Court decides to transfer a case for investigation to the CBI, and accordingly, the CBI takes over the investigation. Whenever a case is transferred for investigation to the CBI, the court also will order logistical support to be given to the state, to the Central Bureau of Investigation by the state government, because the Central Bureau of Investigation, as you know, is a staff deficient.
Okay, sir.
Not like the state police force.
So, there's a question by Advocate R. Vivekan. He's asking,
R. Vivekan.
He's asking, what is the top 10 cases that is typically dealt by CBI?
Pardon?
Top 10 cases that is typically dealt by the CBI.
Which is CBI?
I think the CBI court.
No. I am handling only the cases in Kerala. Not cases outside Kerala.
Okay.
In Kerala, the CBI structure is like this. They have got two offices. One office by the superintendent of police in Kochi, and another office by superintendent of police in Trivandrum. So two offices are manned by officers in the rank of the superintendent of police.
So another question by him is that how is the CBI different from the Department of Police and in approach of collecting evidence?
See, the CBI, it is not that the CBI is different from the state to police, not that the CBI is a body, is an organization that has got any superpowers like the Superman. The CBI is also a similar police organization like that of the state police. But the advantage that the CBI gets is, they are a professional investigation agency, and they are not involved in any law and order business. So therefore, once a case is handled by the CBI, they go into the each and every professional angle of investigation, as is done by the FBI. I happen to watch a movie where it is Bad Match. It's a US movie, Bad Match. That's a case where that's a story of LGBT community. LGBT community, you know what is LGBT community? And LGBT community, the husband and wife, they go for a holiday, and then one lady will be wife, another lady will be the husband, and thereafter this lady, the wife, attempts to murder the husband lady. Then they go out and on the riverside, when she is standing there, she gives a push and pushes him down. Then the attempt is made, and then she cries out, and the persons who are near to her comes for a rescue. And then there is another murder attempt that takes place. Two persons are locked up inside, and thereafter they are beheaded to death. But this lady is spared, and then she is asked to wipe the to clean the floor of the blood there. Then the person who committed the murder, she says, "See, you know, I did not ask you to wipe. Why? Because you should not wipe the blood away. You should only blot it out. Because if you blot out the blood only, then." If you blot the blood, then when the FBI comes, they will not be able to get a trace of the blood by adoption of ultraviolet technology. But if you wipe the blood, then they will still be able to gather the remnants of the blood and also extract DNA. So I was just thinking how the FBI is working. So such type of advanced professional investigation is done by the CBI. That is why CBI is able to get a number of convictions in the court. And another advantage for the CBI, what I have found is, they are, even after filing the charge sheet in the court, they pursue the trial of the case also. When the trial takes place in the CBI court, the CBI prosecutor is assisted by the investigating officer, and mandatorily the investigating officer is always present with his constables in the court when the trial takes place. This takes place in the appeal also. You understand? So therefore, the prosecutor will get every angle of the investigation, and he will be able to aim the. Hello.
Hello. So yeah, we can hear you.
Ah, And the CBI counsel is able to present the case in a really professional manner to the judge, covering the entire aspects of the case. That is why the CBI is in a position to win their cases. That is why their conviction rates are high. It is not that it is to borrow the words of Sivikara. Let me conclude. To borrow the words of Sivikara.
Yeah, sir.
To borrow the words of Sivikara, it is not that the CBI is doing a different work, but they are doing the same work in a different way. Same work they are doing in a different way, that is all. It is not that they are doing any magic.
Okay. Another question from Sridhar Chari is, so when FIR is registered, under what sessions the notice should be sent?
See, section 154 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. Section 154 reads the following. FIR is registered under section 154 of the code. Information in cognizable cases. Every information relating to the commission of a cognizable case, if given orally to an officer in charge of a police station, shall be reduced to writing, etc., etc. Then subsection 2. A copy of the information as recorded under subsection 1 shall be given forthwith free of cost to the informant. Subsection 2 of section 154.
So then another question is, whose duty from Marian Judith, whose duty does it become to further establish or prove the alibi? Does it have to be on the part of both the sides?
No. Alibi is a defense that is taken by the person who is accused of an offense. Alibi is a defense, not an offense. Alibi is taken by the accused only. It is the duty of the accused to prove alibi if he takes up that. Alibi has to be specifically pleaded and positively proved like a fact in issue. And it has to be proved conclusively. That is the problem with alibi. That is why 99.99% of the lawyers do not take up alibi unless they are very poor.
Then another question is, in money laundering case, is it mandatory to write down before search or arrest of accused by the police officer?
What are in money laundering cases?
Is it mandatory to write down before search or arrest of accused by police officer? Is it
Not at all necessary. See, searches takes place in various ways. Searches takes place even before the registration of FIR or even before or after the registration of FIR. It is not necessary that a search should take place. Search can be done only after an FIR is registered. But if a search is done, it has to be done only under two provisions. Under section 51, under section 100 of the Code of Criminal Procedure or under section 165 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. These are the two provisions relating to this. Another provision relating to the search is section 51 of the Code of Criminal Procedure regarding body search. So in all these cases, a search list will have to be taken up. And when a search list is taken up, that search list will have to be attested by witnesses.
Okay, sir. Another one. Isn't it more of that if you go completely according to just the rules and regulations without consideration of natural justice? Justice in its pure form may not be served. Is it still happening? Shouldn't the legal system, especially the criminal side, incline a bit more towards natural justice? Is this a thought, especially with reference to India?
Personally, I very much subscribe to that question. And also I would say that the defense work in India is very much skewed against the accused. And the accused is and the very tight provisions of bail, which are being adopted by the higher courts with respect to very grave offenses like NDPS, murder, treason, etc. Very high. Do not enable the defense advocates to have a full and effective communication with the accused persons, and that hampers the defense work a lot. And another problem with respect to the defense work is that, the defense is also entitled to have assistance of experts, and the question of advancing oral evidence in a case has very much been filtered down in modern times. In modern times, most of the criminal prosecution work rests on documentary evidence as well as digital evidence. When such scientific methods are being adopted by the police officers,
It is absolutely necessary that the defense also must be able to get hold of such advanced techniques. Only then they will be able to attack such evidence, especially that comes with respect to the cross-examination of postmortem doctors. They form a special class indeed. The postmortem doctor does a lot of violence in the case, especially violence to the case of the accused. And probably the opinion that is given by the postmortem doctor, though it is only an opinion that falls under Section 43 of the Evidence Act, and it is only of advisory character. Most of the trial judges are and even appeal judges are very often carried away by the evidence of the postmortem doctor. And it is absolutely necessary that the postmortem doctors are cross-examined effectively by the defense advocate. This can be done only if the defense advocate is properly equipped and fairly educated with respect to the various aspects and angles of the forensic evidence. Otherwise, it will be a fight between the David and the Goliath. True, always David wins.
So, someone is asking to repeat the case name on the missing link.
Pardon?
On the missing link, you had mentioned earlier,
case. But I am not able to get the citation. That is why. Just go into the Google and just say missing link, you will get a number of citations.
Okay,
go into the Google link, type missing link. Because now most people do not have a library. They go along with their tablets, with their mobiles.
Okay,
type missing link, just type missing link plus judgment Supreme Court, you will get a number of judgments. No problem. If you want, I'll get it right now.
Another question is, what is the difference between discovery and recovery?
Discovery and recovery. Recovery takes place after discovery. And discovery is a condition precedent for recovery. Recovery is a condition subsequent and discovery is a condition precedent. You know condition precedent and condition subsequent in contract law?
Yeah.
Study contract. Don't study criminal law. Study contract, transfer property act, specifically fact, code of civil procedure. And the code of civil procedure. These are the five enactments you must be thorough with. Then only you can become a lawyer. Don't study criminal law. Criminal law, you can study after 5 years of your entry in the profession.
Can you just repeat that, sir? What all are the five things that you have learned? Can you just repeat?
I said there's a code of civil procedure, transfer property act, specific relief act, transfer of property act, contract act. These are the five acts.
Okay, sir.
Hey, Lord Denning, have you heard of Lord Denning?
Yes, sir.
The remarkable judgments of Lord Denning have come in contract law.
Yes, sir, another question is about 41A.
Yes, very good, very good. That is a new provision. Section 41A is a new provision that came into the code after the judgment in D.K. Basu's case. And that came with effect by Act No. 5 of 2011. 111-2010, notice of appearance before police officer. The police officer shall in all cases where the arrest of a person is not required under the provisions of subsection 1 of section 41, issue a notice. So that means notice under section 41A is required only in cases where the arrest of a person is not required under the provisions of subsection 1 of section 41. So when section 41 deals with the cases which require arrest, when a police officer may arrest you without warrant. So only in those cases, section 41A is mandatory. Police in all cases with arrest of a person is not required under the provisions of subsection 1 of section 41. So notice under section 41A need to be issued to a person only if he is not a person falling under section 41. Say suppose a person moves over an anticipatory bail application before the High Court. And during the hearing of the anticipatory bail application, the police officer opposing the application for bail takes up a situation that under the investigation so far conducted, he is not in the position to specify as to whether the accused is likely to be arrested or not. And more evidence is necessary. An interrogation of the accused is necessary under Section 160 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. And therefore, there is no reasonable apprehension for the accused to be arrested. And there is no reasonable foundation for the apprehension now shown by the accused that he is likely to be arrested on an accusation of having committed a non-bail offense for the purpose of Section 438 of the Code. In such a situation where the High Court orders that in case you come to a conclusion that he has to be arrested, then you give a notice under Section 41A.
Suppose the police officer arrests him without giving a notice under Section 41A, do you think that the arrest becomes illegal? No, the arrest does not become illegal, because if the Section 41A contemplates giving of a notice only when the person is not involved in a case that falls under Section 41. If the case doesn't fall under any of the provisions contained in Section 41, the notice under Section 41A dehors the question that a note, that such an observation has been made by the High Court in the anticipated bail order is made, you need not do it. And it will not also invite the wrath of contempt. I think that answer is clear.
Yeah. Okay, so this much questions only.
No. Let me tell you, no, very, very sorry that we have not gone into the procedural aspects regarding a witness on stand under the Code of Civil Procedure. Civil procedure is a basic proposition of law. In more than 291 places, the word witness is described in the Code of Civil Procedure. We have not gone through that. We have only been speaking about that class. I will come again later once you give me another opportunity.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah. So.
Any other questions coming?
No, sir. All questions are done.
Yes. So thank you very much.
Yeah, someone has actually asked a question, but is it like the police officer investigate a case and prepare a seizure mahasir, and in that document, statement or confession is recorded by the police officer?
Yes.
The trial judge, as marked as exhibit in the case, this statement can be taken into account to welcome accused into the guilt. Is it possible?
Yes. Can anyone tell anyone? Because I am very poor in constitutional law, but I am very much aware that there is
Article 21.
Pardon?
Article 21 of the Indian Constitution.
Not Article 21. I am reminded of a provision in the Constitution where the principle of ultra vires is made with respect to a legislation. I think it is Article 13 of the Constitution. Am I correct?
Yes, absolutely.
My proficiency in constitution is very, very poor, but I am just reminding things that I studied around 40 years back. That is Article 13. Article 13, I think it is under Article 13, the principle of ultra vires is discussed. In my limited understanding, Article 13 deals with the laws in the derogation of fundamental rights. In applying the principle under Article 13, I think the principle is made applicable, which is called as a blue pencil test. Have you heard of that? Probably, am I correct in saying so?
Yes,
blue pencil test. So therefore, in constructing a statute, whether it is within wires or without wires, the court adopts the principle called as the blue pencil test. In applying the principle of the blue pencil test, the court decides which part of the statute is in consonance with the constitution and which part of the constitution is not in consonance with the constitution. And by applying the blue pencil test and also by harmonizing the provisions, the court comes to a conclusion that the portion of the statute which is against, not in consonance with the constitution, is cut away. And that is to say that the cancer is chemotherapized, and thereafter the provision which is consistent with the constitution is allowed to leave. Similarly, in its application of the blue pencil principle in the criminal court, a recovery mahasir recorded under Section 27 contains a part of a confession statement which is inadmissible under Section 25, but a portion of which is admissible under Section 27 also, and that results in a discovery, instead of destroying the entire seizure mahasir and demolishing in toto, the courts normally lean by adopting the principle of blue pencil, and they will cut away the statements regarding confession which are inadmissible under Section 25 and allow the part of the information which is admissible under Section 27, and thereafter allow the mahasir to be read into evidence.
Have any letters positioned to support this? Have any letters positioned to support this? Letters decisions?
Decision, the old decision of the Privy Council, 1947 Privy Council 39, Pulukuri Kottaya versus Ambaran.
Oh, yes.
Where Lord Arkin says knives were discovered ages ago. Like, you remember that?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Read the Privy Council. Privy Council decisions are gems. Because yes, you find the shortest and the briefest possible decisions there.
Yes,
but it explains the law very well.
One thing also, sir, that confess statement can be recorded separately by investigating officer concerned?
That's a very interesting question. That's a very interesting question. See, you know, a head constable was in the box in a theft
case. Yes, sir.
Hello. A head constable, was in the box in a theft case.
Yes.
His evidence was to the effect that the accused was questioned after having registered the crime and arrested the accused. The accused was questioned and during the and after and after having been questioned, he gave information regarding the place where the articles of theft were kept. And then thereafter, the accused took me to his house and from the kitchen slab, he took out the stolen articles. And thereafter, I wrote the master marked as Exhibit B1. The information which is supplied to me marked as Exhibit B1A. The thieved article is marked as MO1. Okay. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In the cross examination, the question was asked to him. See, you know, Exhibit B1A is the information leading to the discovery, isn't it? Yes, sir. Obviously, it was written after the recovery.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you. No more questions.
Okay, fine.
No more questions. The cross-examination ended there. Then the magistrate immediately wanted to know why you are asking that and why you are keeping silent after finishing this. Cross-examination is not over. Please explain. Then it was said, no. Nothing to be asked. Nothing else. Only cross-examination is over. Nothing else. Then the matter came up for argument. It was argued like this. That is, obviously, the witnesses admitted that the recovery statement was recorded after the discovery. So, there is no information leading to the discovery for the purpose of satisfying the principles contained under Section 27 of the Evidence Act. So, the recovery mercer is constructed first and thereafter the recovery statement is made. So, there is no information leading to the discovery, but the discovery leading to the recovery. Discovery leading to the information. This is like putting the cart before the horse.
Yes. Yes. That, sir, what is the authorship of concealment?
Pardon?
Authorship of concealment.
That is another strategy that has now been there for even if the recovery master fails by reason of these cross examinations that is it now. The judge is very open under the umbrella. I will say, yeah. Under the umbrella of the principle of the authorship of concealment. True, the recovery master fails, the information fails. True, it does not come under Section 27 also, but the fact that you led the police to a place from where the incriminating article was recovered itself is a very clear indication to show that you are the author of the concealment. If you are author of the concealment, then by reason of Section 106, a special fact, especially within the knowledge of you, explain it.
Sir, another doubt, sir, that in a trial said only on the basis of the 27 recovery the accused can be convicted.
Yeah, yes, but then now the Supreme
other witnesses are turned hostile, even the witness also.
See, 27 recovery evidence is the evidence, primarily it is the evidence of the police officer who gets the information.
Yes, sir.
And makes the discovery.
Yes, sir.
So it is not the business of the witness regarding all this aspect. The evidence of the witness is only corroborative. Yes. If you believe the evidence of the police officer, why should we go into the evidence of the attesting witness? The question of going into the evidence of the attesting witness arrives only when there is some shortfall in the evidence of the police officer, and therefore the court is of the opinion that it requires corroboration. When the court itself is of the opinion that there is no corroboration and corroboration is not required, and the evidence of the substantive evidence given by the police officer alone is sufficient to warrant a finding of fact that the accused is the author and the accused gave the information and it led to the discovery, then the police officer is an officer who has to be treated like any other ordinary witness. Why should there be any corroboration for that evidence? But this principle is not often adopted in very grave offenses like murder. Like I have come across several decisions where the Supreme Court has said that on the recovery evidence alone, you should not come to a conclusion that the accused is guilty. Very recently, don't ask me the citation, but I remember there is a decision of the Supreme Court where the accused had even given an information that led to the discovery of the dead body. But the Supreme Court said that merely because the accused has given only the information under Section 27, that alone is not sufficient to find the accused guilty of first degree murder. So therefore, the net effect of the upshot of the discussion is this: in a criminal trial, there are no hard and fast rules. There are no clear-cut principles. Every case turns on its own fulcrum. And a wide discretion is given to the judge to decide the case in this way or that way. That is why most criminal lawyers tell you, don't study the law, study the fact. Muhammad Ali Jinnah was a very famous criminal lawyer. And somewhere I have read that Muhammad Ali Jinnah used to argue cases without opening the brief. He used to swallow the facts as it is. And he used to repeat the fact as it is before the court. He was very thorough in facts. And first principle of a criminal law practitioner is a thorough digest of the facts on hand. And not the law. Law will come second hand.
Sir, another question.
It is like a cream on a Christmas cake.
Yes.
If you only have the cream, where is the cake? And if you don't
facts. Sir, another question. What is mean by hit by 162?
Excuse me, sir. We are currently 12 o'clock, so.
There are two more questions to be answered.
Definitely. This is being a Sunday. I enjoy being with me.
Sir, one question by my side. Sir, one question my side. Yeah. What is mean by hit of 162?
Pardon?
162.
A beautiful question. Beautiful question. See, 162 is a unique provision of law which you find under the Code of Criminal Procedure. Now questions have come whether Section 162 of the evidence of the Code of Criminal Procedure is a rule of evidence or a matter of procedure. Rule of evidence or a matter of procedure. Because you find such a similar provision under Section 145 of the Evidence Act and also under 157 of the Evidence Act. So therefore, the next question is, what is the difference between Section 145 of the Evidence Act and Section 161 of the Evidence Act? Answer can be answered very easily. Section 161 does not operate in a civil case, but in a civil case also the plaintiff has to be contradicted. See, suppose I am a vendor in the sale deed. I give up an evidence in the court against the averments in the sale deed, where I am the vendor. Immediately, you as a finance counsel will take the sale deed and contradict me with respect to the averments in the sale deed. How do you do that? Which provision do you adopt? You are adopting Section 145 of the Evidence Act. But 162 is a principal rule of evidence which is confined exclusively for criminal cases. 162 is a principle that forbids the use of the police statements in evidence. That forbidding is for the police or is for the prosecution who is conducting the prosecution. When the prosecutor is leading the witness to the facts in issue and also the relevant fact, the statement under Section 161 cannot be touched, neither in the re-examination also. But you being a defense lawyer can contradict the witness with respect to the aspects in the 161 statement given by the witness to the police. And then the question is regarding the validity of those 161 contradictions. Contradictions are of two types. Contradictions have to be material and significant, and also omissions. An omission also will become a contradiction. Omission becomes a contradiction only if it is significant and material. Supposing a very important omission is left out in the 161 statement, which is spoken to by the witness during the trial. Then you point it out to the statement to the witness, bring out his, refresh his memory and tell him that, when you were questioned by the police on such and such a date, you have not stated so in your police statement. What do you say? That amounts to an omission. That omission amounts to a contradiction. Then explanation to Section 161 also says where an omission amounts to a contradiction, amounts to a contradiction or not, is a question of fact. It's a question of fact.
Yes.
I think is that answer okay?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Yeah, the fundamental decision on this point is Tahsildar's decision, Tahsildar's case. Yes. That is 1957 AR.
to Sanaya.
Supreme Court judgment. I'll see the case.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
But all the scope of using this contradiction becomes operative only in cases where the witness is under an 161 statement. But where the witness comes under the NDPS case or under the Customs Act, where statements are given to the police officer, to officers other than police officers, where is the scope of contradiction? Because those statements will be ultimately repeated, tail by repeated sentence by sentence by the witness. And the scope of contradicting that witness may not be of much use. And also, this art of using the statement for contradiction is, let me tell you, is a super art. This can be done only by very experienced cross-examiners. Because using the statement given to the police under Section 161 always is involved with the danger of giving an opportunity to the police, to the public prosecutor, to open the 161 statement and thereafter confront the witness, bring the witness and refresh the witness to those parts of the statements which have been referred to in his cross-examination. See Section 161. Let me take you to Section 161. A minute. My friend is now opening his mouth. He's getting bored. By
all no.
Very sorry. See, Section 162. See, the danger of Section 162. You are, in fact, opening a Pandora's box. Then, proviso to Section 162. And when any part of the statement is so used, any part thereof may also be used in the re-examination of such a witness, but for the purpose of only explaining any matter referred to in his cross-examination. See, you know, what happens is, when the police officer records the first 161 statement, that statement is natural. Witness speaks the truth. Thereafter, going through the 161 statement, the police officer understands that this statement is rather detrimental to the prosecution. So immediately he will issue another summons under 162 and record another 161, where the omissions and the contradictions, etc. of the earlier 161 are again clarified by the subsequent 161 statement. So naturally, the first 161 statement is used by the cross-examiner and thereafter contradicted by the witness. Then the witness will say, yes, it is true, I have stated like, but then I was again called by the police on a particular day and then I was questioned also. Then the prosecutor will get up and say, see, you know, were you not questioned on this day? Yes, sir. Then were you not questioned on this day also? Yes, sir. Then is it not correct if I put it to you that you have stated like this to the police officer? Yes, sir. I have stated like that to the police officer. That means it will fall under the proviso to Section 162. But then in one trial, in which I had the humility of being a participant therein, the subsequent statement was used by the prosecutor. Then, see, the language under Section 162 says, thereof. Did you see that? Thereof.
Yes.
Thereof means statement on that day. Same statement. You understand? The second statement.
Yes.
Not the second statement. I don't think that there are any decisions on this point. It's a very hard task. One thing I can say, use of this 161 statement is like, see, suppose you are going to study, learn kalarippayattu. Okay.
Yes.
Hello. You are going to study kalarippayattu. Immediately, yes. on going to start the kalarippayattu, you see that several weapons are placed there. Immediately, you will have a desire of taking the sword there and starting practice.
Yeah.
The Ashar will not allow you to do that. Isn't it?
Yes.
Ashar will not allow you to do that.
No.
First, you will have to learn the steps, and learning the steps will go for at least 5 years, and then only you are given the weapons. Am I correct?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Now, why it is so? I mean, if you take the weapon at the first time itself, your opponent will take the weapon and cut your head off.
Yes.
The same thing applies to 161 statement also. See, 161 statement is a statement which requires a lot of practice to be used successfully, especially against very intelligent prosecutors, and take it from me, hostile courts. See, you know, in every criminal trial, what happens is, you are now defending a case where there is a sensational murder case. You are the defense counsel.
Yes.
The witness is against you, agreed?
Sure. Yes.
Police is against you, agreed?
Yes.
Press is against you, agree?
Yes, absolutely.
Yes. The visual media is against you, agree?
Absolutely.
Then all your friends in the bar,
Sure, I guess me. Yes,
they are very, very happy.
Yes.
and ultimately, you are burning the midnight oil to somehow save this client who has done a crime. You lose the case. Yes, he sentenced to death or he sentenced to life. Then who is against you?
Yes.
The client is also against you.
Yes, sir. Sure. Absolutely.
This is the tragedy of a divorce lawyer.
Right now, basing.
Am I correct?
Yes, sure. Absolutely correct.
Okay.
So there's another question.
Yes, madam, come.
So what about the latest judgment in DPS? In the NDPS.
You are talking about the Bajinder Singh's case.
Yeah, case Sridhar Chari.
No. I think the latest judgment regarding Section
15. No, he's the one who asked.
Bajinder Singh's case.
He was the one who asked the question.
Sir, please come to that, sir. Which is that latest judgment?
Case Sridhar Chari, sir.
Now, what is that? Please explain that. About what?
I am asking him to unmute, but he is not unmuting.
I have not read that judgment, madam.
Quantity of the drugs, sir.
Quantitative analysis.
No. Quantity of the drug.
Quantity of the drug is determined by the notification, isn't it? Small quantity, commercial quantity, and intermediate quantity. You must be referring to the quantitative analysis. You must be referring to the lab test.
The latest judgment regarding the quantity of the drug in blot.
Can you give me the citation? I'll be very happy if you can give me. I have not read it. It may help me in some of the cases that I have. Give me that citation.
Sure, sir.
Give me the citation, sir.
1 second, sir.
Is it by the Apex Court?
Yes, sir.
If it is defense friendly and if it is by any other high court, you cite it before a session judge.
Michael Raj judgment, sir.
Pardon?
Michael Raj case.
Michael Raj was my client. Yeah, Michael Raj, I defended him in the sessions court. Okay. In the sessions court, I took up the contention regarding quantitative analysis. That contention, it was Deep Apachan was my district judge. And he said that is a stupid contention. Then I came up before the High Court and argued the same point before one judge here. That judge went against, that is a reported judgment. Then I will tell you the history of that case. He was a very poor fellow. And that time I wanted to take it up to the Supreme Court, but he had no money. He had only 5,000 rupees. Then I said, with 5,000 rupees, you cannot even approach an AUR. Then one of my friend was an AUR in the Supreme Court. Then I asked him, please, can you arrange some lawyer? That time, Mr. K.V. Vishwanathan from Andhra Pradesh, he had just started his practice in the Supreme Court. Then he took this brief to Mr. K.V. Vishwanathan. Then I had a discussion. Then I said, sir, only 5,000 rupees is with the client. Please be kind enough, sir, take up the case. What, Mr. Rajit Kumar, what are you saying? Then he took up the case because of this academic interest. And it was argued. And ultimately, Michael Raj was decided in favor of the accused. And the Supreme Court went on to say that the quantitative analysis should be there in order to find out the actual quantity, actual drug content. And Michael Raj came out of the jail. Michael Raj was my client. I defended him. Yeah, just give me this decision. Probably it may be of help to me. Please give me.
Sridhar, sir.
Ask him to give me that decision, madam.
He asked you to give the decision.
Yes, sir. The Supreme Court said that if that drug is...
Citation, sir. Sir, give me the citation.
The citation of the case. Sir, please give sir the citation of the case.
I will find out. Until.
Okay. You don't have it. Then I will find it out. Okay. Thank you.
So another question is, can silence of the accused during the examination under Section 313 be taken as an adverse inference under Section 114G of the Evidence Act?
What is 114G? 114 is in the realm of evidence.
Santosh Kumar, sir.
Eh?
Santosh Kumar, sir, please unmute yourself and ask.
Hello.
Yes.
Good afternoon, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, can the examination of the accused person under section 313 of the CRPC, when he remains silent, can it be taken as adverse inference under section 114G of the Evidence Act?
Generally going by the principle under section 114G, sir, and section 313, it falls under two different statutes. 114G falls in the Evidence Act, and section 313 falls in the procedural law, that is the code of procedure. CRPC does not deal with the evidence. Section 313 also specifically says that the statement given by the accused, subsection 3 of section 313, says that it shall not be used as an evidence against the accused, and it can only be used as an evidence against him in some other inquiry or trial. So therefore, going by the principle under section 313, and also by the fact that these two things fall under two different statutes, it cannot be used against the accused. But going by the larger decision of Justice Sadashivam, probably there is some reason in finding that if the silence of the accused is able to give an eye-opener to any facet of the prosecution case based on the circumstantial evidence, and if it leads to a missing link, filling up of a missing link, probably that can be used as an incriminative part of the evidence. But then I have got my own reservations on this point. Subsection 2 of section 313. Subsection 2 of section 313 says that after the evidence of the prosecution witnesses are over, and before the accused enters on his defense, the accused is questioned under section 313. So the questioning under section 313 takes place after the closure of the prosecution evidence. So section 313 is based on the incriminating evidence that has come up against the accused in the prosecution evidence. So if the 313 statement of the, if the 313 answers of the accused, or even the silence of the accused, is allowed to be used as evidence against the accused in order to supply a missing link against the accused, how can you say that there is any evidence when the prosecution evidence is already closed by reason of subsection 2 of section 313? So therefore, does it not result in an intellectual anachronism? That is point number one. Then point number two is that now section 114G is a principle of evidence which is used only for the purpose of appreciating the evidence, and that is in the realm of appreciation of evidence. There is no question of appreciation of evidence. There is no question of using it in the realm of evidence so far as section 313 is concerned. Section 114G is a principle that is given against the person who is going to give evidence, not against a person who is a subject of that evidence. So reading section 114G in this perspective, we are constrained to say that section 114G presumption, cannot be used. This inference cannot be drawn against the accused. I will bring around an example also, very interesting example, where a special judge was trying a case where a very senior criminal lawyer was defending the accused. And as you know, there is a principle under section 275 or 276 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, which says that the evidence will have to be taken in the presence of the accused. So that means the evidence should be audible to the accused. So the witness were speaking in very soft tones, and then the defense lawyer began repeating to the judge that the evidence of the witness is not audible enough, either to the defense counsel or to the accused who is standing in the dock, and therefore the witness may be directed to speak aloud. But the judge got furious and said, no, the witness is speaking things which are very much audible to me, so I need not speak anything to the witness now. I am writing it down, so you will not be prejudiced. Then the trial was over. Then the accused was put under section 313. Then the judge began asking questions to the accused, each and every question. For each and every question that is asked by the judge to the accused, the accused began answering like this: "Sorry, I did not hear. Sorry, I did not hear. Sorry, I did not hear." What inference can you take in such a case?
Sure.
It really happened in a court here.
So another question is,
thank you, sir.
Has there been any reopened cases in your profession? And can you please share the reopened cases by CBI, like a noble theft case?
Where are we? Reopened case means, what do you mean by that? Case Hello, a reopened case means reopen in what way?
Ma'am, can you please come forward?
Pardon?
Anu AS, can you please come forward and?
Yeah, please.
She is not unmuting herself. I send her the invitation.
Oh, sir, is any reopened case in profession? That is what you are seeing.
Yeah, in your profession.
Madam, could you make yourself clear a little bit, Anu madam?
She's given an example saying noble theft case.
I am not aware of that case, noble theft case. But what do you mean by reopened case? Reopened case means a case where it has been investigated by the local police and it has been closed as no evidence, and then the matter has been taken by the CBI and the CBI put up a charge sheet against the accused. Is that a case that you are referring to?
I think she is referring to that only.
Are you referring to that such a case?
I think so, sir.
Okay, I will tell you of an example where I happened to defend an accused in a murder trial, where the allegation was that father, son and mother, they were living in a house. There was some dispute of family property between the father and the son, and the father was running a small provision store. In the morning, the father had given some loan to another person. And then the father said, then the son received a call. And the son told the father that the man is ready with the money. He can go and collect. Then the father got out from the house. It was early morning by around 4:30, 5 o'clock. Then he went to the house of the person who borrowed money from him. And then the further development in the case was that he was found dead in front of his borrower with a neck slit open, died. Case was taken up by the police against the borrower, the debtor, and the family. They were arrested. They were put under prison. And then the case was taken up by the crime branch also. Crime branch also put up a charge sheet against the debtor. And after some time, they were enlarged on bail. Then the son came up with a writ petition before the High Court, stating that the investigation by the local police is shabby, and stating that all the persons who are accused in the case have not been traced and arrested. And that case came up before Justice Bashir, who is now Lokayukta of Kerala. Then Justice Bashir, along with his co-judge, heard the matter and thereafter found some substance in the contention raised by the son, and thereafter directed the CBI to take up investigation of the case, which has been investigated and found to put filed by the local police. The CBI took up the investigation, and during the course of the investigation, the CBI found that the borrower, that is the debtor, they are not guilty. The murder was committed by the son in conspiracy with the mother in order to accelerate succession to the property, and the son was arrested. The mother was made a principal witness in that case, and the son faced a trial in the Sessions Court of Special Judge of the CBI. Case got convicted. Son was convicted of first degree murder. Appeal pending.
So another question is, Section 154, subclause 1, first provisio, information shall be recorded by a woman police officer or any woman officer. The woman officer mentioned related to whom?
Woman police officer, all persons who are in the service of the police are called as police officers. The officer will take in the name of, he will take in a lady police constable also. Now the post of constable is not there. It is only woman police officer. That amendment has come with respect to the proviso, provided that if the information is given by the woman against whom an offence under section 326A, 326B, 354, 354A, section 354B, 376, etc., etc., such information shall be recorded by a woman police officer or any woman police officer. That is in consonance with the gender equality. Because as you know, ladies do not have any faith in men, no? Ladies think that men are inferior human beings. Am I correct?
No.
Am I correct?
I don't know.
Pardon me?
I don't know, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir, we are done with the questions.
Yeah.
Yeah, all questions are answered by you, sir.
Okay.
Anything you want to tell us to our young?
Very sorry that nobody took me to the provisions contained in the fundamental law, that is the CPC. If you don't know CPC, what are you going to do with law? First, you study CPC. CPC, Transfer Property Specific Relief Act, Contract Act. Nobody asked me anything about that. The cream of law is in the civil law. Studying criminal law is like, have you heard of Christopher Marlowe? Who wrote Dr. Faustus? Have you heard of that? Christopher Marlowe?
No, sir.
Oh, Christopher Marlowe, who gave his soul. That is Dr. Faustus. Dr. Faustus gave his soul to the devil on a contract that the devil will come after 25 years, quarter of his injury, and ask for the soul to be dragged to the hell. For 25 years, he will be given all the pleasures in the world. If you want the Hell of Troy to come alive, then the Hell of Troy is recreated, and Hell of Troy lives with him as his wife for some time, like that he enjoys the whole world. And ultimately a day comes when the 25-year quarter century period is over, and Dr. Faustus, the soul of Dr. Faustus is drawn to the hell by Mephistopheles. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Come for very well in life. Okay, yeah. Remember me sometimes. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Sir, you will have to come for our next month webinar also, sir, because like we have got a great response for this lecture. People have actually liked the lecture as we are getting the feedback on the chat box. So, sir, you'll have to come for the next month webinar also, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you, sir, for joining us, and thank you,
Padma. No. When you say that, what remembers me is regarding the, I think it is the 13th Party Congress, which was held in the United States of Soviet Union, where after the death of Stalin, Khrushchev took over as the premier, as the Russian president. You know that?
Yes, sir.
You know that story? Then Khrushchev was giving a big speech regarding the dictatorial and autocratic attitude of Stalin and how Stalin was able to suppress the entire democratic process in Soviet Union, and that there was nobody to speak against him, and Stalin was a diabolic evil in Russian society. There has to be a process to be called as de-Stalination to be initiated by the communists in the USSR. Everybody was hearing this speech of Khrushchev in silence. Then somebody asked, who was sitting there in the audience, somebody asked, sir, when Stalin was there doing all these things, you were a member of the Politburo, where were you? Then immediately Khrushchev heard the question. Then Khrushchev asked in return, who said that? There was absolute silence. Nobody answered it. So I don't know what sort of a remark I will get after I go out of this session. Thank you.
No, sir. You're
okay.
It was a very nice session, and thank you, participants, for joining us also.
Yeah. Okay.
This webinar also. Hope to see you in the future webinars also.
Thank you. Right. So shall I leave? All the best.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, and guys. It's a request to all of you, please like, follow and subscribe our Facebook, YouTube and Instagram page, because we are a growing platform, so we need all of your support. Please,
yeah, like, please approach this. Record. You have recorded this, no?
Yes, sir.
The meeting has been recorded and it will be uploaded next week.
Kindly put it in the YouTube.
Yes, sir.
It will be uploaded to our page, The Outspoken Narrative. Okay, please, guys, do thank subscribe us. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us. Thank you so much.
Thank
to
you,
all of you.
Sir. Thank you, participants. Please go subscribe to our page. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you from the team Outspoken Narrative.